Lord, treat everybody right. Even the ones that don't treat me right. Treat everybody right until I die. Amen, amen.
Amen.
Our scripture for today is taken from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 19. We're going to begin with verses 1 through 3. And we're going to actually make our way down through chapter 19. But we're going to begin with verses 1 through 3. I want to thank both our praise team and Inspirational Choir for good rehearsals yesterday. Thank you for your faithfulness and thank you for lifting your voices this morning. I'm going to trust in the name of the Lord. That's a good one. That's a good one. Jeremiah chapter 29 verses 1 through 3. Amen. Will you now rest on your feet for the reading of God's word? From the New King James Version of the Bible, the Word of God reads, Thus says the Lord, Go and get a potter's earthen flask, and take some of the elders of the people and some of the elders of the priests, and go out to the valley of the son of Hinnom, which is by the entry of the potsherd gate, and proclaim there the words that I will tell you. And say, Hear the word of the Lord, O kings of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, Behold, I will bring such a catastrophe on this place that whoever hears of it, his ears will tingle. Let us pray. Father God, right now in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this worship opportunity today. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth that is found in your word. We ask, Father, that today you would show us a vital sign that will help us to always have our hearts and our minds turned toward you. As always, Father, I pray very humbly that you would allow your Holy Spirit to work through me for your glory, that this body of Christ will be edified, and you, Holy Father, will be glorified. Work a miracle in us, God. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated in the presence of God. I want to thank our ushers this morning for your service. Today, we're going to continue in our series entitled Vital Signs. Vital Signs. I don't know about you, but this series has been a blessing for me to see what it is that God is doing, to see how it is that God is reaching out to his people, how he's speaking to them. Through the major prophet Jeremiah, God is giving his word, he is giving visions, and he is giving signs. And we're paying attention to those signs this month. And these are some things that God is revealing are very important for our Christian faith. These are things that are very important for our spiritual growth and for our spiritual maturity. I don't know about you, but I want to get better. I want to be more like Christ. I want to have my life begin to conform to the scriptures because I know that when I'm walking according to his word and according to his will, that I'm walking on a path of blessing. So I pray that for you, you have the same desire as we go through these scriptures together. In the first week, we began this series and we talked about a sign of separation. We looked at how God called Jeremiah to move, to not do the things that other people around him were doing. How many of you know that we need to be in the world but not of the world?
Amen.
You know, we need to have something different on the inside of us. We need to have something better at our core. Well, last week we looked at the vital sign of restoration where God tells Jeremiah to go down to the potter's house. And there we saw that God is sovereign and that God can do whatever he wants with the clay. How many of you are willing to let God mold you and to make you? Because I'm going to tell you right now, if you go the opposite direction, it's not very good for you. It's not very good. So today we pick up in chapter 19. The potter's house was in chapter 18. We pick up in chapter 19. And the sign we're going to look at today is a sign of desolation. It's a sign of desolation. And Jeremiah has been instructed by God in this chapter. Ironically, he just left the potter's house, and then God says, go find a potter's flask, an earthen flask. Take it with you and go and get some of the elders of the children of Israel and go get some of the elders of the priests, and let's head out to the potsherd gate. And there, God told Jeremiah, I want you to proclaim catastrophe. Mm-hmm. Now, this is something that we don't always hear about God, so I want you to stay very focused this morning. We know about God's love, and we know about his grace and his mercy, but we also know that our God is a God of wrath, and our God is a God of desolation. So we are going to learn some things about it today. Amen? So let's pick up with verse 4. This is Jeremiah chapter 19, beginning with verse 4. He says, because they have forsaken me and made this an alien place, because they have burned incense in it to other gods, whom neither they, their fathers, nor the kings of Judah have known, and have filled this place with the blood of the innocents. Verse 5, they have also built the high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings to Baal, which I did not command or speak, nor did it come into my mind. God says, I'm sending catastrophe on my people. And I want you to go out here and I want you to realize I'm sending them catastrophe for a reason. It's because somehow, somewhere along the way, they have forsaken me. My people who understand that I am the God who is the creator of the heavens and earth, I am the God who brought their ancestors out of Egypt and then through the Red Sea. I am the God who controls the seasons and the weather. I am the God who sends the rain and the latter rain. I'm the God who makes their crops grow. I'm the God who opens up the matrix and allows children to be born. I am that God, but for some reason, they have decided to go find some other gods to do what only I can do. And that's a problem. That's a problem because God said that you shall have no other gods before him. That's a problem because God, the God that we serve, he is worthy to be praised from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. His name is worthy to be praised. They have the temple right there, Solomon's great and grand temple, right there in Jerusalem, and yet they still find a way to go out into the woods and make monuments out of trees so that they can worship Baal. And they found ways to go and get on top of their houses and to worship the sun and the moon. And they were doing these things to get benefits that they, for some reason, they didn't want to wait on God. They decided, I need a little help. My crops need to grow. Somebody told me if I just go worship Baal, my crops will grow. Somebody told me that I can have more cattle if I worship Ashtoreth. Somebody told me that I can have a good rainy season if I worship the moon or if I worship the sun. And they went out and they started to worship other gods in order to get close, to get more than what they already had. The issue here is not so much about, watch this, it's not so much about sin, it's about worship. Worship is a vital sign. Worship is a vital sign that you are growing in your faith. If you are a person who still has not learned to acknowledge God for who he is and to worship him, you still got a way to grow. Here's the thing, we will worship and seek after and pay respect and reverence to all kinds of things besides God. You don't have to talk about all of them, but that's what we do. Some of us walk away from God. Some of us walk away from giving him glory. Some of us, just like those people in Israel and in Jerusalem, were seeking some other source to provide for them instead of God. They stopped reverencing God. And what they did was they withheld their worship. They withheld their reverence. And we're just as guilty. This is not just about singing.
Right.
Did you hear that?
Yeah.
This is not about singing. Tell your neighbor, this is not about singing.
Not about singing.
Tell them, this is not about raising your hands. It's not about clapping and rocking. This is a heart issue.
Yes,
this is something that needs to happen on the inside of us. This is something that needs to happen down in our core, and it's called worship. If you're going to worship God, don't we may show it in the signs of our raised hands and our clapping and our rocking and our singing. The truth is, Jesus said, if you're going to worship me, you've got to worship in spirit and in truth, which means that it has to be something that starts on the inside of us where we acknowledge God for his glory. We need to stop giving honor and reverence to everybody and everything else and pause and give God the glory. That we should acknowledge God when there are blessings in our lives. That we should acknowledge God when there are trials in our lives. That we should acknowledge God when good things happen to us. That we should pause and give thanks and praise to God even when we're challenged. Because for the children of Israel, when you read the Old Testament law, you read all these ordinances about how to worship, and they were to worship in every season of life.
Yeah.
They are to honor God in every season of life. They are to give thanksgiving and thank offerings in every circumstance. Let me ask, did God do anything for you this week?
Yeah.
Did he bless you this week?
Yeah.
Did he provide for you this week?
Yes.
Well, did you come in this morning and at least say thank you, Jesus?
Yes.
Entering into his gates with thanksgiving, entering into his courts with praise. Did you at least say thank you? When the good things happened to you this week, did you pause and say thank you, Jesus?
Yes.
Did you pause and really give honor and reverence to God for what he had done in your life? See, some of us have some issues with this because we're, help me, Lord. We are so aware of what God is doing in other places and so aware of what other people have that sometimes we are not thankful for what we have. So what if you're not eating T-bone steak? You thank God for the hot dogs. You thank him for it. Because there's somebody somewhere in the world that would just give everything in their head just to have a hot dog. See, you got to learn how to, in your heart, recognize God for who God really is, and that's what they failed to do. And because they failed to do this, they failed to honor God, they failed to exalt him, they failed to adore him, they failed to give him glory, God says, I'm going to bring a catastrophe. I'm going to bring a catastrophe on this place that is so strong that it will make your ears tingle. All of this because of worship. Because worship is not just when we sing or dance or we clap. Worship is a lifestyle. Worship is a condition of our souls. It is a condition of our hearts. And it's something all of us must learn to do. If you're not at that place yet, and let me testify. When I first got saved, all I wanted was the Word of God. I just want to learn the Word. I want to read the Word. I want to learn the Word. I want to know what the Word is talking about. I want to be able to explain the Word. I'm going to be a Christian. I don't want to be ignorant. I want to make sure I know that I know that I know. And I studied and I studied and I studied. And I would sit in worship services and I would just sit there. And I wouldn't clap. Because in my mind, I was trying to exegete the song. I'm trying to figure out if the song was biblical or not. Are they singing about praise the Lord? Now, what scripture is that from? And I'm just sitting there. I'm not giving God any honor. I'm not giving him any reverence, any praise. And I did that for a long time after I got saved. And then one day, God broke my heart. And when my heart finally got broken, that's when I realized, oh, wait a minute. It's all right for me as a man to lift my hands.
Right.
It's all right for me to cry in his presence. It's all right. And I don't care what you got to say about me. You can call me weak, whatever you want to. You better understand it's not weakness, it's meekness. And blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. You can talk about it all you want. If I have to lay down prostrate before him on my face, it's because I know that God is God and I am his creation. And because of that, I learned how to worship. And I'm saying this because some of us are still struggling with it. I'm not going to talk about you. All right. Now don't y'all look at each other. But you know a lot of Sundays. All right. I got to say it, a lot of Sundays. We are the frozen chosen. Yeah. And some of us think that we are saved to sit. Yeah. But God has called us to greater things. Yeah. Worship is a vital sign. Yeah. Amen?
Yeah.
Let's continue through the scriptures. Let's drop down to verse 10. I want you to know that judgment is vital. Judgment is vital. Verse 10, Jeremiah 19, verses 10 and 11 says, "Then you shall break the flask in the sight of the men who go with you, and say to them, Thus says the Lord of hosts, even so I will break this people and this city as one breaks a potter's vessel, which cannot be made whole again. And they shall bury them in Tophet till there is no place to bury." God has Jeremiah to go get an earthen flask, one that's already made. This is not like the potter's house where the clay is still soft and the clay is still wet and you can mold it into whatever you want. This is permanent. This is a flask that he is holding, a clay flask. And the Lord tells him right out there, and it's so symbolic because God wanted to give them a mental picture. They are outside of the potsherd gate, and down in the valley by the potsherd gate, that's where all the refuse from the city went and all the trash went. And there were fires that burned down there constantly because they were always trying to burn the trash. And while he is there standing in front of this scene of what you could very well say, and in one way looks like a living hell, he says, "I want you to take that flask and I want you to destroy it. I want you to smash it on the ground." And he says, right here, I want them to see a picture of doom and destruction and judgment because they have failed to worship me, because they have failed to reverence me and honor me as God. I am bringing destruction, total, complete, and utter destruction on this people. How did we end up in this place? We ended up in this place, it began back with Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve, they sinned, and when they sinned, you know what happened? Death came into the world. It wasn't just physical death, it was also eternal death. When Adam and Eve sinned, every person was born with a sin nature. We are all born in sin. Did you hear that? I know some of you don't believe it. Y'all believe y'all was good little boys and good little girls. But we were all born in sin. We were born in with a sin nature, and because of sin, there is a penalty for sin. And it is called death. Let me show you something. This is the situation we're all in, okay? Well, not all of us. Praise and thanks be to God that some of us have heard his call and we have given our lives to Jesus. Amen? Somebody clap your hands for salvation. Okay? But let me show you a condition that everybody is born into. Let's go to John chapter 3. And we're not going to verse 16, you know, for God so loved the world. We're not going there. We're going a little further down in verse 18. John chapter 3, verse 18. Listen to what Jesus is saying to Nicodemus. "He who believes in him," talking about Jesus, the Son of God, "is not condemned." Everybody hear that?
Yeah.
That's good news, eh? Yeah. If you believe in Jesus, you are not condemned. "But he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." Let me tell you something. From the moment a child is born, From the moment a child is born, and though we celebrate and we thank God for new life, when that child is born and is born with a sin nature, and if that child grows up the first time, that child says, when the mother asks her, did you get the cookie out of the cookie jar? And the child says, no, with chocolate all over his face, then we know that that child has lied. Guess what? He is a candidate. He is already condemned to eternal death. That's harsh, isn't it? But it's the reality. Without Jesus Christ, we are condemned already. That's why I don't worry about preaching fire and brimstone, because people are out there living in fire and brimstone. They're already living a life where if God came back for them today, they would not be in heaven. Only those who have believed in the name of Jesus are not condemned. Did you hear that? Who does this apply to? It applies to everybody. Well, how does it apply to everybody? The Bible tells us, write this down. Romans 3:23. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Think about the best person you know, the nicest person you know, the person that you think never did anything wrong. Guess what? They sin too. They sin, you sin, I sin, we sin, everybody sin. The difference is somebody believed in Jesus and somebody did not. Well, what exactly is sin? Now, I know I've been using that word. Let me explain it. I want to make sure you understand. The word for sin in the Bible is an archery term. Imagine a bullseye. Imagine you've got a bow and you're about to let your arrow fly with your bow. When your arrow hits the target, if it doesn't hit the middle, the bullseye, the distance from the bullseye to where your arrow landed, they would measure it, and it was called sin. It means you're off the mark. It means you missed the perfect mark. It means you didn't hit dead center on your goal. And here's the issue. The issue is that God has a mark for how we should live. God has a mark for how we should go about our daily lives and how we treat one another. And when we miss that mark, when we lie on one another, when we hurt one another, that being off the mark, that's what's called sin. Let's look at it in a little more detail, because I want you to understand. Let's go to Galatians 5:19. I'm teaching this morning. Put your Bible away. Galatians 5:19. 19 and 20. Actually, 19, 20, and 21. Judgment is vital. Amen? Amen? Galatians 5:19-21. Y'all with me?
Amen.
Look at this. This is Paul speaking to the church at Galatia. He says, now, the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, meaning there's more, and the like. Of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. There's a list right here of some of the things that people do when they miss the mark. And when you miss the mark over and over, you do not inherit the kingdom of God, which means you automatically inherit God's wrath. Who am I talking about? I'm talking about liars. I'm talking about thieves. I'm talking about murderers. I'm talking about covetous people. Did you realize that covetousness is a sin? Which means that you're always wanting something somebody else has. Every time you see it, oh, I want that. Covetousness. You miss the mark when you do that. Gluttons and disrespectful people. Children, it is a sin to be disrespectful towards your parents. Adulterers, fornicators, homosexuals, any type of sexual immorality. Hateful people. Oh, you're just hateful. Then it's judgment for you. If you're a person who practices practices being unforgiving, if you're a person who practices being selfish, if you're a person who practices being a gossip and a busybody, if you're a person who practices being a false witness, if you're a person who is a drunk or a medium or you're practicing witchcraft or sorcery, all these things are going to face the wrath of God. And what we must understand is, whether you see it happening or not, judgment is real. I don't think you heard it. Judgment is real. For those of you who think that the devil is a figment of your imagination and hell is not real, hell is real. Hades is real. Guess what? Destruction that comes from God is real. Just because destruction happened doesn't mean that God didn't either make it happen or allow it to happen. We're talking about a God who told a city, I'm going to destroy your city because you did not worship me. And as an end result, thousands of people died. You need to know that judgment is vital. Eternal death is real. Eternal separation from God is real. The end of the world is real. And guess what? When it all happens, when God pours out his wrath, it doesn't go back in the bottle. There is no second chance. Just because the wrath hasn't been poured out yet doesn't mean it hasn't been prepared. Why is this a vital sign? It's a vital sign. Judgment is vital because every believer needs to have a healthy, realistic understanding that there are consequences for our actions. You know how we do sometimes. I'm not going to talk about you, but you know how we do sometimes. We come to church and we know what we did. And we know that we've been living in sin. And because we know how to dress it up, and because nobody in church has happened to know, because some of us have gotten really smart about it, we just go across the state line and do our dirt. But the thing is, the thing is, just because you think you got away with it doesn't mean God didn't see it. And it doesn't mean that God doesn't have consequences for it. You see, those of us who are saved, watch this. We know that we have grace. We have amazing grace, how sweet it sounds. We have grace that when we fall, we can pray and ask for forgiveness. That's great. But even though I know that I can ask for forgiveness, I'm not going to ride grace. I'm not going to stay on grace because I still fear the judgment of God. Every believer needs to have that inside of them, this healthy understanding that judgment is real, so that the next time you think about going to do what you do, when you do what you do with the people you do it with, you might think twice. And you might actually turn around and go the opposite direction. You need to know that there's a God in heaven who is looking down on you, and that there's a God in heaven who understands right from wrong, and that there's a God in heaven who wrote the rules of what's right from wrong. And when he sees these things happening, it's being written in the book of life.
Yeah. Yes. All right. Yeah.
Judgment is vital. Judgment is vital because if we understand it well, maybe we'll strive a little bit harder against sin. Maybe we'll strive a little bit harder to get our lives right. Maybe we'll stop making excuses and saying, the Lord knows my heart. And oh, you know, every once in a while is okay. No, it's not. It's not. Lastly, your response is vital. Your response is vital. Go to verse 14. Jeremiah 19 and 14. I know this is heavy, but let's go through it together. Jeremiah 19 and 14. Amen?
Amen.
Then Jeremiah came from Tophet, where the Lord had sent him to prophesy. So he has now left from the place where he was, where he broke the flask. He has left from Tophet. And he stood in the court of the Lord's house and said to all the people, Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel. Behold, I will bring on this city and on all her towns all the doom that I have pronounced against it, because they have stiffened their necks that they might not hear my words. God says, I'm going to bring all of the doom. All the catastrophe. Pour out all of my wrath. Everything that I said I was going to do. And he says, the reason why I'm going to do it is because I sent them my word. I kept sending them my word through the prophets. Jeremiah has spoken words on my behalf. They have heard my word. They have heard my truth. And at the end of the day, they stiffened their necks. They rejected God's truth. They had hardened hearts. Some of them probably even looked with a high brow, thinking that they were just so much better. Some of them just had some stubborn backs and some unbelief, faithlessness. They became obstinate. They became contrary. They became resistant. Why do we act this way toward God? Why do we do this? Why is it that when we hear a word, help me, Jesus, we hear a word, come across the pulpit, we hear a word on the radio, we read a word in the scripture, and God is speaking his truth to us, why is it that we just let it blow over? And it goes in one ear and comes out the other, or maybe it just bounces off. We've got layers upon layers upon layers of these ideas of who we think we are, and will not allow God to tell us who we are. Why do we do that? Let's go back to John 3. John chapter 3, verse 19. I'm going to tell you why. John chapter 3, verse 19. You read John 3 and 18, right? Those who have believed on him are not condemned. Amen? Amen? Those who do not believe on him are condemned already, right? Look at verse 19. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. Ladies and gentlemen, we like dark. Red man, don't say that about me. Yes, David. We like darkness. Because some of us will confess, now don't you go down that street and don't hit every house along the way. But some of us will confess, our darkness feels good. Wait, you can't say that in church, so don't you amen and don't you nod your head. But you know when you drink the right drink, in the right quantities, it feels good. And it seems like the grass is greener on the other side, so it always feels good when that man or that woman flirts with us, even though we're already married. It feels good. It just hits our ego. It just floats our boat. Don't let them compliment us and tell us our dress look pretty old. We start switching in. About to throw your hip out because it helps you.
All right.
When we take something with our sticky fingers and we didn't have to pay for it, we feel like we've accomplished something. We feel good about what we stole. We feel good when we tell somebody else off. We feel good when we hurt other people. We feel good sometimes when we're out doing our dirt in the darkness. We love the darkness. And we need to stop telling ourselves there's nothing wrong with it. Oh, you know, because everybody else is doing it. And if they're doing it and nothing happened to them, like I said, just because the judgment has not, the wrath has not come, doesn't mean it hasn't been prepared. Just because they seem to have gotten away with it doesn't mean that it's okay for you to just say, well, I can do it too. And the last thing I want is for Reverend Manuel to start judging me. Oh, you know how we do. I'm going to do what I do. I'm going to live the way I want to live. And don't you judge me.
Come on, Pastor.
Listen, we're not judging you. That's God. That's scripture. Well, the Lord, he know your heart. And he know that it's got that darkness in it. And it is he who will judge you. It's not us. When we talk about sin at church, let me tell you something. When we talk about sin at church, it's because God told us to talk about sin at church. It's not because we're trying to call you out. It's not because we're trying to put a spotlight on you. The truth is, when the light comes, the light of the Word of God comes, it shines on you even anyway. We don't have to work at that. All we got to do is start telling the truth. And when we start telling the truth, then all the darkness becomes exposed. And the problem that we have is some of us love the darkness so much that we cower away from the light. We begin to ease away from the light. When the light of the truth comes, we get really quiet. We don't want anybody to know. Some of you have mentally and emotionally during this sermon right here, some of you have mentally and emotionally taken your sin that you used to wear so proud on your shoulders and you've tucked them in your pocket. When we face the light, when we face the gospel of Jesus Christ, We, not just you, not just me, we are all exposed. All of us. And the problem is, though we are exposed, we need to be careful about how we respond. You see, the people in Jeremiah's day responded with a stiff neck, meaning they refused to turn. I'm just going to keep doing what I've been doing, the way I've been doing it, and it's been fine so far. And I'm happy, and as long as I'm happy, that's what counts, because God wants me to be happy. And I'm going to keep going out and being in places I should not be, doing things with people I should not be with. I'm going to continue to live this life, and I don't care what the prophet says, I don't care what the preacher says, I don't care what the Word of God says, I'm doing me, baby. And when they begin to have that stiff neck, God said, it's justified. If I bring the judgment on you, it is justified. So we must be careful about how we respond when we hear the truth from God. Because there is a God in heaven. If you didn't know it or not, there is a God. He is alive and well and real, and he holds the universe in his hand. And that God has a holy standard that he expects us to live by. And when we fail to meet that standard, there is nothing but wrath and destruction and judgment for all of us. We're talking about desolation. Something you cannot recover from. Something you cannot come back from. Something that you can't bargain your way out of. Something you can't bribe your way out of. Something you can't talk your way out of. You either accept Jesus Christ as Lord of your life, or you just find yourself in a burning hell. And that's just the way this thing works. God is trying to speak to his people and make them understand it is vital. It is vital that we all understand the truth of our eternity. God sent his son. God sent his son. He sent his son to save our souls. He sent his son with a message about his kingdom. He sent his son to create a new covenant with us. One that is not based on the law. You see, in Jeremiah's day, they were living under the law. And because they had broken God's law, there was nothing left for them but judgment. But if we now, under this new covenant, accept Jesus Christ through grace and faith, though we may fall, we can get back up again. Though we may make mistakes, God will still forgive us.
Though we may turn in the wrong direction, we are given grace and the opportunity to turn back to the right direction. But the question is, how will you respond to Jesus? How will you respond to the truth that God sent him to die to pay the penalty for our sins? How will you respond when Jesus, through the person of the Holy Spirit, shows up on your job and tells you to do what's right when everybody else is doing wrong? How will you respond when you're tempted to go and do some things? And Lord have mercy, I don't want to talk about everything that we could possibly do, because we've all done it. All of us have fallen short of the glory of God. But when those moments come, we are tempted and it seems like more than we can bear. When the Holy Spirit gently nudges us to turn in the other direction, how will you respond? It's not just once. It's not just when you come down on a Sunday morning and you give the preacher your hand and give the Lord your heart. It's how you're going to respond when God shows up in your life on Tuesday. How are you going to respond when God gives you an opportunity to make things right again on Wednesday? How are you going to respond when God is trying to minister to you and to turn your life around? Whatever you do, when he speaks, when he moves, when he provides, when he heals, when he cautions you, don't have a stiff neck. Don't have a hardened heart. Don't have a stubborn back. Don't have a contrary spirit about you. When the Lord moves and speaks and does things in your life, the difference between living a blessing and living a curse, the difference between eternity and glory and eternal judgment, is found in how you respond. What will be your response? The doors of the church are open. If you are here today and you've never responded, you've heard the gospel, you've heard the good news, you've heard about this church,